morning, and welcome to church this morning. I want to welcome you. I also want to welcome the people that are watching on the internet as it's live streamed. We thank you for joining us anytime that you can. If you are a guest today, we encourage you to join us for lunch. We have a lunch in the fellowship hall. If you don't know where that's at, just grab somebody and ask them. There is a lunch today, potluck lunch today, and we invite you to that if you are a visitor. This coming week, starting on Monday, we are starting our community-wide week of prayer. Madison Campus Elementary, Madison Academy will be having week of prayer. Our pastoral staff will be visiting us with that and giving us our messages during the day. And then in the evening, we will be having a week of prayer here. The nice thing is it starts with a dinner. So it starts with a dinner at 6 o'clock, starting on Monday. And then the meeting will start at 6:45, and I've been told that the meeting will not go past 7:30. So we want to invite you to that. If you have any questions, look at the Pastor Ken's newsletter or ask anyone here at the service today. Tomorrow there is a work bee. We will be cleaning up around the pond tomorrow at the work bee at 1 o'clock. It will start at 1 o'clock. If you have a hard copy of the current this year's Bible readings, they are asking that you get an updated, corrected copy from the kiosk out front. And then again, there will be, on Thursday, we're going to have the rescheduled church board meeting, Thursday, January 17 at 7:30 p.m. in room 109. I don't see, are all the pastors here? Not yet. We just have one pastor. We'll keep moving on until the pastors get here. We'll do that once they all arrive. We're going to, today, I'll just tell you ahead of time, today they are all giving sermonettes. I think that's what they're called. And what we are doing is we are going to pick numbers out of the hat for the order that they will be presenting their sermonettes. We truly believe that the Holy Spirit can lead in the timing, and so we want to do that. We were supposed to have all the pastors here, but we'll do that after we go ahead and have the call for offering. I want to ask those that are picking up the offering to go ahead and come forward. We're going to actually also have the pre-K and kindergarten classes from Madison Campus Elementary come up. They'll be presenting our music during the offering. And so we'll go ahead, and while they come up, we'll do that. I'm going to step forward a little bit because they're going to stand right where I'm standing. So we're going to do that as I give the call for offering. Today's offering is for the Kentucky-Tennessee Advance. The Kentucky-Tennessee Advance helps with both of our academies, both Madison Academy and Highland Academy, as well as Indian Creek Camp and many other evangelistic things that we do. I want to encourage you to give to this. This is the group right here. A lot of our evangelism, Kentucky, Tennessee is very good at working for our children in many things they do. And so I want to encourage you as the offering plate comes by to give freely and willingly. So let's have a prayer for our offering. Oh, dear Heavenly Father, thank you. Thank you for all that you do. Thank you for the Sabbath. I really appreciate the Sabbath, and I thank you for that. Lord, I want to ask that you bless us and keep us. I want to ask that you bless the children that are about to perform. I want to ask that you bless the offerings that are going to be given. These are your offerings, Lord. This is your money, and I ask that you lead it and that you give it where it needs to be and that it does what you want it to do. We love you so much. In Jesus' name, amen.
Ascension, born in serve the land, hope in
sing that song, and it's just amazing, just amazing. I do want to say something as I invite the pastoral staff to come up. I do want to say something about your pastoral staff. I hear from them and see them all the time. They are so active in our schools, in our school especially, I know, and I just want to thank them for that. They are a huge influence, and I want to thank them for what they're going to do next week with the Week of Prayer. They come in, they do Bible studies, they do chapels, and it's just amazing. I talk to other principals, and that doesn't always happen, and so I just want to make sure you understand what this group of people are doing in your school. So, as we said earlier, we want to let the Holy Spirit lead. And so what we're going to do is we're going to let them pick a number out of the hat, and then they're not even going to share it, so they don't even know. So if you have any nerves about getting ready to speak, you might just be as soon as I walk off the stage and have to speak. So I'm going to go ahead and pass those out, and then we will get started with the sermonettes.
This Sabbath, and thank you for this opportunity to praise you through music. We love you and ask that you come into this place and into our hearts.
Thee will I cherish, thee will I honor, thou my soul's glory, joy.
Hallelujah. Paul was a smart guy. He was trained as an attorney, and he was easily able to hold his own in pretty much any philosophical discussion. We can see his education flaunt its prowess in the complicated logical arguments that he uses to correct and edify the various churches to which he writes so many letters. This guy was no backcountry shepherd bumpkin, okay? He was a straight A Harvard grad, metaphorically. Even though in the beginning of his career, he was a harasser of Christians, eventually he used his education to glorify God. Paul was ambitious. For the early Christians, this was a terrifying character trait. But once God had Paul playing for the correct team, his self-starter personality took him on 3 incredible missionary journeys around the known world, and that's pretty impressive. Paul was also a confident and powerful leader. Even though he was not one of the original 12 disciples, the respect that his guidance received from the burgeoning Christian church was nearly unmatched. To say that Paul was an asset to the early Christian church is a gross understatement. God knew what he was doing when he picked Paul to work for him. And so, Paul had plenty of reasons to pat himself on the back for his many skills, which he used to complete the work that Christ had given to him. And yet, all of his education, all of his determination, all of his leadership skills meant absolutely nothing to Paul compared to the simple fact that he knew Jesus. He had had a personal encounter with his Savior. Jesus had addressed Paul by name, knocked him to the ground as he had set out to persecute Christians, and changed his entire life. We can read the story in Acts chapter 9. Paul, originally called Saul, was on his way to arrest some Christians when an encounter with Jesus stopped him in his tracks. And the very first thing that Jesus said to Paul put the whole thing into perspective. In Acts chapter 9, verse 4, Jesus himself says to Paul, "Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?" From the very first moment of their relationship, Jesus made it known to Paul that it was personal between them. And so, later on, when Paul addressed the Corinthians in our key verse for today, he stated in no uncertain terms that the only thing that he knew or cared about was Jesus Christ. So, 1 Corinthians 2:2, our scripture for today, Paul writes, "For I resolved to know nothing while I was with you except Jesus Christ and him crucified." Nothing compares to a personal relationship with the person, Jesus Christ. The most eloquent sermon in the entire world is rubbish compared to a whispered prayer in your darkest hour of need. The most irrefutable argument cannot move you to decision the way that the simple fact that God so loved the world that he gave his only son can. And a life lived in near perfect adherence to the standard will not and cannot save you. In John chapter 5, we read about some religious leaders who knew the scriptures inside and out, but who were confronting and questioning Jesus on his authority. And as you read this chapter, you can almost feel Jesus's anguish and frustration as he confronts them when he says in verses 39 and 40, "You search the scriptures because you think that in them you have eternal life. It is they that bear witness about me, and yet you refuse to come to me that you may have life." Church family, let us never forget that all of this is about a person. And that while we should never, ever stop learning, we should never stop growing, we should never stop expanding our knowledge about the character of God as revealed in His Word, and yet, we should never allow ourselves to substitute knowledge for relationship. So let us resolve, like Paul did, to center ourselves on the person of Jesus Christ and Him crucified. Know Jesus, grow in Jesus, follow Jesus, because you guys, it's all about Jesus.
The riches of this world will fade, the treasures of our God remain. Here I empty myself to owe this world nothing and find everything in You. The riches of this world.
Largest city in New Zealand. It has about 1.5 million people living there. It's situated between two gorgeous bays and has over 50 volcanic dormant volcanic craters there. I served as a youth pastor there, and one of my responsibilities as a youth pastor was to pick up kids and take them to different events. Well, this was the days before there was GPS and cell phones. Some of you may remember them. Some of you, you're like, what is this? This was a thing? It was. And so the only way to find your way around was to get some instructions or a map to find your way around. Well, I've never been good at instructions or maps, and so I was constantly getting lost. I was constantly late. And one day after showing up late again and being clearly flustered, one of my church members looked at me and he said, Ken, look up. He said, look up. There's in the center of New Zealand, there's this huge volcanic mountain crater thing right in the center. Look up and then use that to figure out where you're at in the city. If you look up and look at that, it doesn't matter where you can figure out where you're going to be. Now, I thought, that's ridiculous. I will still be lost. You do not know me. I will be completely lost. But I got desperate, and so I tried it out. Next time I was lost, I looked up, and sure enough, I thought, no, wait a minute. That's this. Okay, if I head this way, and sure enough, I found my way. I found my way. As soon as I looked up and did something that was a little bit, for me, counterintuitive. All four of us are preaching off of 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 2. Paul says, for I determined not to know anything among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified. This is a change of pace for Paul because when he had been in Athens previous to being in Corinth, he had used logic, he had used wisdom. He had tried to out-logic the Athenians with his skill and to prove to them that Jesus Christ using logic and human wisdom. And it hadn't worked out for him. And so as he prepared to go to Corinth, he made a very conscious decision. He decided to only talk about Jesus Christ and him crucified when he went to Corinth. Why do you think that Paul didn't just say, I determined to know nothing but Jesus Christ, period? He very deliberately adds, and him crucified. This becomes an even bigger question if you look at the previous chapter. In the previous chapter, Paul says in verses 22 and 23 of Corinthians 1, he says, this message of a crucified Christ is foolish to the Jews who ask for signs from heaven, and it's foolish to the Greeks who seek human wisdom. So when we preach that Christ was crucified, the Jews are offended, and the Gentiles say, it's all nonsense. So why does Paul decide to take a nonsense approach to evangelism? Why does he say, that's clearly not going to work. They're not going to accept it if I say it this way. Instead, he does the counterintuitive thing. I want to talk about something that is ridiculous to both Jews and Gentiles. I wonder if Paul, in his reflection, thought of John 8:32. I know he didn't have John back then, but I wonder if those words of Jesus came to his mind. And I, if I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all men to myself. Jesus is making allusion to the fact that he's going to be crucified. But for Paul, an Old Testament scholar, it had to also take his mind back to the book of Numbers, chapter 28, where the children of Israel are wandering around in the desert. They're upset yet again with Moses and with God, and they're complaining, and they're blah, blah, blah. And in the midst of that, God sends poisonous snakes, venomous snakes, among them, and they start biting the people. And the people begin to die. And the people cry out, help us. Hey, wait a minute. We're sorry about that. Help us. And so God says to Moses, I want you to create a bronze serpent. I want you to raise it up on the pole in the center of the camp. And whenever anybody looks at it, they'll be healed. Now, that had to be crazy. How is looking at a bronze replica of what bit you going to save you? And yet it does. All those who in faith look up and look to the center of the camp and see that bronze snake are healed and live. I wonder if thinking on that, Paul came to the realization that his strategy in Athens was great. He's intellectual, he's smart, But the fact of the matter is that your genius won't save anybody. That Paul's intelligence, his persuasiveness, his personality have nothing to do with being effective in sharing the gospel. He alludes to this in Colossians chapter 2, verses 8 through 10. Beware lest anyone cheat you through philosophy and empty deceit according to the tradition of men, according to the basic principles of the world, and not according to Christ. For in him dwells all the fullness of the Godhead bodily, and you are complete in him who is the head of all principality and power. Don't be cheated. Paul realized that philosophy is a cheat. Intellectualism is a cheat. The truth is in Jesus Christ and him alone. And the power of salvation is in his cross. That's why he changes it up in 1 Corinthians. That's why he says to them, I want to know Christ and him crucified. Why? Verses 4 and 5 in chapter 2 say, and my message and my preaching were very plain. Rather than using clever and persuasive speeches, I relied only on the power of the Holy Spirit. I did this so you would trust not in human wisdom, but in the power of God. You see, it's not any of our genius that will bring you to Jesus. It's the Holy Spirit. And when the Holy Spirit changes you, you suddenly realize that it's not about what you do. It's not about how smart you are. It's not about anything other than the fact that the Holy Spirit lives in you and now has the power to change you. This year at Madison Campus Church, as a family, we want to rely only on the Holy Spirit. It will not be our genius plans that bring success and growth to Madison Campus Church. It is only the power of the Holy Spirit, coupled with the message of Jesus and his cross, that will bring success. This year, we invite you to turn your eyes to the center and look up.
was fun, but it loses interest quick. Saying things you thought you'd never say, but somehow you did. And old records play and sing until 2 a.m. Breaking down your walls, breaking down your defense. And if you're living just to live, to make it through, know that he is so much more in store for you than paying bills and waiting for your funeral. Oh, baby, don't forget your walking miracle. Feel like you're in the middle of a hurricane. Feel like you're lost and you don't even know your name. You'll be okay. And if you're living just to live, to make it through, no.
You know, the Corinthian church was not very different from our church. They had all these different religions trying to persuade them that they were the right one. They had all these different philosophers and teachers and leaders and scholars and even preachers, all of them fighting for their attention. And it's in the midst of this that Paul writes down these words and he says, you know, I desire to know nothing, nothing except Christ and Him crucified. I mean, as Chelsea mentioned, it's Paul, the genius Paul, the one who writes more than half of our New Testament. He's the one who writes these words. And I think he writes these words because Paul understands, above everyone else, Paul understands more than anyone else what it's like to study the Scriptures and not know Jesus. Paul, of all other peoples who could have written this, Paul has experienced himself knowing all the Scriptures, thinking that he's actually following God, and he knows that there's a danger to just words alone. It's the same Paul who wrote down in Galatians 1:10, am I still trying to persuade men or God? If I was still trying to persuade men, then I can't be a slave of Christ. You see, Paul understands that religion, any world religion, including Seventh-day Adventism, without Jesus, it's simply this. It's men and women trying to convince other men and women that they're good people. Paul understands this better than anyone else. that religion, if you strip Christ away, if you strip Christ and his crucifixion away, then it just becomes a game. It becomes this game we play where we just try to impress one another, where we try to convince one another, and we do it by the way we dress, by the way we speak, by the words we use, by where we go, by who we associate with, all in an effort to try to convince other men and women that we're good people. And what this leads us, it leads us to this attitude that we have where we stop looking at each other as brothers and sisters, and we start looking at each other as potential enemies, potential critics. And it's this is the reason why Paul reiterates, I don't want to know anything else except for Jesus and him crucified. You know, Aunt Ellen, or Ellen White, I like to call her Aunt Ellen. I don't know why. It stuck on me, like, for a while. Our young adults know this. She writes this. I think it's really important. She tells us all that we should spend an hour a day contemplating the last moments of Jesus' life. I'll be honest, I don't always do this. I really don't. This year, it's something I've actually been trying to do. I don't know if I'll be able to keep it up through the whole year, but I know what it's done for me for these past 2 weeks. And I hope it's something it will do for you. As I reflect on Jesus' life for about an hour a day, in his last moments, I realize one thing. I realize that I'm a sinner. And I'm not talking just like throwing that name out. I realize there's something ugly in me. There's something ugly in me that is trying to win. And I know, and I realize I need some help. And it helped me to realize something else. When I started focusing more on my sin instead of the sins of others, it helped me to see people, and it's helping me to see people as people instead of as objects. This is what Paul's trying to get us to. He wants us as a family to see one another for who we are. And Paul, more than anyone else, understands this patience. He understands the patience that Jesus had because it's Paul. It's Paul the one, when he writes down, you know, for this we know, this is how we know that Jesus loves us, because while we were yet sinners, he died for the ungodly. Paul isn't speaking about those out there. He's speaking about himself. Because Paul, more than anyone else, knows that to persecute Jesus' followers is to persecute Jesus himself. And so he asks us, and he invites us to just focus on Jesus. Jesus and his death alone. And maybe two things will happen. We'll recognize who we are. We'll recognize that everyone else is also a child of God. And maybe together we can walk together and encourage one another as we struggle through this journey.
Hello, family. Jesus is in our center here on the window. May it be even more true that he's in the center in our hearts as a church. Brothers and sisters of Jesus, I am so glad to be here and to be part of that fellowship. I'm going to read that scripture again, and I'm reading it from the Message Bible. And slightly different emphasis, so absorb these two. Paul says, I deliberately kept it plain and simple. First, Jesus and who he is. Then, Jesus and what he did. Jesus crucified. My sister and I had some good seeds starting us. We got to grow up around Union College, practically across the street from Union College. And we were very involved in Sabbath school and church school and JMV on Sabbath afternoons and Pathfinders. And it was a good place, a good way to grow up. I got a lot of honors. I wanted honors. Mostly about nature and sewing and things to do and make. However, the one that I want to mention today that was different than the others was the orienteering honor. So then they introduced me to a compass, and the whole understanding, of which I can only touch the edge, that there is a pole running through this planet Earth, and there is a north pole start to it, and that gravitational pull of that makes this amazing Earth go round and round and creates the safe and beautiful place that God made for his children, for us. I also learned that I really didn't want to get lost in the woods by myself. And so even when I've been lost, I've been with someone else because all dials and all of that, whatever. But I learned something of the value of those things. Earth's centeredness is vital to life here. My sister and I both grew up there, and around year 2000, she was able to build what I would call her dream home. Some of you have been able to do that. Some never will build that here. I just got to help her a little bit. She called me in as the floral designer in her life, etc., to make it extra, extra her and extra beautiful. So we enjoyed that experience together. Then we hit the year 2004. I doubt that maybe, did anybody know anyone in Port Charlotte in 2004? It happens that was my sister's birthday, August 13. It fell on a Friday, no less, and she really wasn't so worried about the boxes that came in the mail as she was boarding up the windows of her house because Hurricane Charley was coming their way. And the prediction did not underestimate the damage. It was a horrible, horrible experience. Many lost homes, some lost lives during that hurricane there. She rode the hurricane out, and then there was a curfew because all electricity was gone and water and everything else threatened, and looting was a big problem. So you were supposed to stay in your home, whatever of it was left, at night. However, my sister, with all of those seeds planted about nature and God and prayer, had to leave her house. She said she was compelled to get away from that mess, but she had to do it in the dark. 20 feet of debris, in most cases, was piled up on each side of her street and those around it. So my sister is walking through that darkness because she's looking for something. She's looking to talk with God himself, but she's also looking for the Dipper, the Big Dipper, and she wants to get grounded, centered in something. So she looks for that North Star. She finds it. And I had her retell me the story just in our recent visit. She said, "Oh, I remember it so well. I called out to God and I said, 'Oh God, I get it. You, not this house, are my true home.'" Strange birthday present, isn't it? But the centering that she got there, she was ready for, she needed, she sought it, and she found it. True north, centered on Jesus himself. Some of you here, I know, are right now facing trouble and tragedy and not sure of the way through. There is a North Star. There is a Jesus in the center of this turning globe, and he seeks a personal relationship with you. The two most torrential storms I've experienced were not hurricanes. I stayed away from Florida at the right time, I guess. One of them was my graduation day. I was 19, and my dad announced that he was leaving, and he wasn't coming back. That made my greatest fear be that could somehow happen to me again. My mother was 40 when that happened, and when I was 40, I and my children experienced betrayal also. Shaking experience, faith-shaking experience. But I thank God that I had known Christians. I had teachers. I had pathfinders. I had all those things to draw on. But my walk could no longer be anything but daily centered on Jesus. It can take us through the storm, and we may go many directions depending on how long our storm lasts, but we need Jesus. I need him. I want him. I seek him daily. I can't wait for the storm. He tells us, "You will seek me and find me when you search for me with all of your heart." It's easy to kind of do that with a half heart, isn't it? It's easy to be distracted. It's easy for the storm to throw us off center. But he's promised we will find him. I have found it true. I need it every day like Nacho, I have to admit my need, my sinful need, my spiritual need, my fears, but I find him faithful, true north. He is there. He is the light that each of us need. Jesus is the home of our dreams. During this day and this week of prayer, I call you to build your house on that rock. We sang it last week, didn't we? Who gets the storms, the wise men or the foolish? Both. Who goes through? Those who are looking clearly for Jesus. Those who are grounded in centered Jesus living. And I thank God that he can make that be. He has promised to finish the work he's begun in each of our hearts. Just make that your center.
Morning. Oh.
try to find peace, knowing that all will be well, and your heart will feel lighter, everything will be brighter. Find peace, knowing that all will be well in the morning. In the morning, all will be well, all will be well in the morning. In the
this morning that you would like to have prayed over, I want to invite you to come forward. And any of our elders who are here and our pastoral staff will gather around you. But if there's a burden on your heart that you're carrying today, I'd invite you to come down while we have our prayer of the morning. If you need to give your life to Christ, I'd invite you to come down and kneel during our prayer of the morning. If you're doing that, if you're giving your heart to Christ for the first time, please let one of our pastoral staff know that so that we can be sure to follow up with you. But if you have a burden on your heart, you want to give your life to Jesus, if you realize you need to make him the center of your life, I want to invite you right now to go ahead and make your way forward. Everybody else, if you'd like to kneel where you're at, we're going to go ahead and have our prayer of the morning. Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for your love and your kindness and your mercy to us. We want to thank you for family, family that we call Madison Campus Church. Lord, I pray that many hearts this morning have heard you speak to them, that they haven't heard Chelsea or Nacho or Julie or Ken speak, but they've heard you speak to them. I pray that you would help us to make you the center of our life. Help us to make you the center of our life. Lord, for those who are listed on the screen behind me, you know each need. You know each name. Lord, I pray that you would be with each name and each need. But I also ask that their family, you would inspire us to reach out. Not to wait on somebody else, but us to reach out to those on that list that you impress on our hearts to reach out to. Lord, we ask for your blessing today. We ask that you would bless us as we leave this church and go out into a world that needs you. May you help us to share the good news. Help us to be centered as we do it. We pray in your name. Amen. I'd like to remind you that this week, on Monday, we begin our week of prayer right here in the church. The pastoral staff are doing week of prayer at Madison Campus Elementary and Madison Academy in the morning. And then in the evening, we'd all like to get together at 6 o'clock. Food is provided. So this is a week you don't have to make supper. You can just show up and have supper. So we're going to fellowship from 6 to 6:45. At 6:45, there will be a worship service that will go until 7:30. We will be done at 7:30 because I know you have school and work and all kinds of other things. So We'll be done at 7:30. Please take the time to be here as a family to start this year off right together. Next Sabbath is going to be our ministry Sabbath. You don't want to be late to church. Early service begins at 8:50. Second service begins at 11:20. We're going to have a very short service inside of here. And so if you're late, you'll miss it. And then we're going to go out through the church, and we have all of our ministries that are going to be scattered around the church. We'll have a map for you. You'll go find them, learn about them, and we have some amazing prizes to the people who actually visit every ministry and get their signature. So there's some pretty amazing gifts if you do that. So you don't want to miss next Sabbath. We're looking forward to seeing you then. God bless you. Have a great Sabbath. You're dismissed.